First off, thank you, Mike, for blessing us with that music. It was absolutely wonderful this morning. Thank you very much. Good morning.
Good morning.
We welcome you to Beautiful Savior Lutheran Church. We're glad to see that you're here to worship with us this morning as we continue keeping it real here at Beautiful Savior with our sermon series on the Psalms. Pastor Tom is going to be talking about Psalm 123 today, so he'll explain more about that in his time in his sermon. So we pray for God's continued blessings on his message, on our worship this morning, that God would open our hearts and our minds to receive the gifts that he has to give here today. And so would you please stand? And we worship this morning in the name of our God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our liturgy, our order of worship will be found on the screens. Let's join in singing our gathering hymn. Dear friends, as we gather as God's chosen people, once more we find ourselves seeking his promised forgiveness. Together we confess, gracious God, we come stumbling into your presence. We have found our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips struggle to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of regret. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open us to a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in the likeness and image of Jesus Christ, our loving and forgiving Savior. Amen. Dear friends, Jesus has promised that the sins we forgive on earth will also be forgiven in heaven. Therefore, trusting confidently in that precious promise, I declare to you that in Jesus Christ and because of Jesus Christ, all of your sins are forgiven, and you are free to share that same forgiveness with all others in your life. Dear friends, you are forgiven and you are free. live, love, and rejoice in that freedom. Amen. Let us pray. God of the covenant, in our baptism, you call us to proclaim the coming of your kingdom. Give us the courage you gave the apostles, that we may faithfully witness to your love and peace in every circumstance of life. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Kristen.
I'd like to invite the children to come forward for the children's message. If you're visiting with us today, you can certainly come down too, and you're welcome to bring an adult or a friend with you if you'd like. Come on down. Come have a seat. Hi, Louie. Hi, Cody. Come on over. How you doing, Bodie? Good morning. Good to see you, ladies. You look bright and springy and summery. Look lovely. Good to see you all this morning. We are continuing. Come on down. We are continuing our talk about the Psalms today. Have a seat. Hi, have a seat right there. You can turn this way if you can and look up here. And the Psalms are actually the songs of the Bible. They are the songs that Jesus sang when he maybe was your age, or anyone is their age. Jesus would sing these songs, and our psalm today reminds me of a song from my favorite movie. It goes like this. Let's start at the very beginning. A very good place to start. When you read, you begin with what? A, B, C, right? And when you count, you begin with 1, 2, 3. That's not in the song. But our psalm today is Psalm 123, or 123. But I started with 1, 2, 3. And when you go at the beginning of Psalm 123, we start with God. That's a good place to start, with God. Every day, we need to look up to God because we need God. We can't do it ourselves. We can't do the right thing because we're sinful. And we need God in our life. So every day we ask God for mercy. And mercy means we ask God for forgiveness. We ask God for his kindness. We ask God for love. And it's only God that can give it to us, no matter who we are, no matter what we do. God gives us his mercy because of Jesus. Because Jesus died on the cross and rose again for us. And that means God gives us his mercy every day, every single day. And not only that, but he wants us to share that mercy with others. So today I'm going to teach you a song about 1, 2, 3 to help you remember, okay, what Psalm 123 is about. And it goes like this. And you're going to repeat it after me, but let me sing the first verse. They're going to repeat it too, so we won't be singing alone, okay? It goes, 1, 2, 3. God loves me. Each day he gives mercy to me. Can you try that? 1, 2, 3. God loves me. Each new day he gives mercy to me. Very good. That's the first verse. Second verse is, make sure I got it right. That's what happens when you make up a song. All right, ready? 3, 2, 1. Through his son, I can share his mercy with everyone. Okay? Sing that part with me. 3, 2, 1. We're going to count down. Ready? 3, 2, 1. Through his son, I can share his mercy with everyone. Okay, will you pray that with me? We're going to sing it as a song and pray it together. Remember, the first time we count up and the second time we count down. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3. God loves me. Each new day he sends mercy to me. Now we go down. 3, 2, 1. Through his son, I can share his mercy with everyone. All right, remember that today? Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming up and singing with me. Thanks for coming. Thanks for singing, everybody. Let's go.
A reading from the Psalms. To you I lift up my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens. Behold, as the eyes of servants look to the hand of their master, as the eyes of a maidservant to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look to the Lord our God, till he has mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy upon us, for we have had more than enough of contempt. Our soul has had more than enough of the scorn of those who are at ease, of the contempt of the proud. The word of the Lord.
God, my God, I cry out. Your beloved needs you now. God, be near, calm my fear, and take my doubt. Your kindness is what pulls me up. Your love is all then draws me in. I will lift my eyes to the maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the oceans raging wild. I will lift my eyes to the healer of the hurt I hold inside. I will lift my eyes to you. God, my God, let mercy sing her melody over me. God, right here, all I bring is all of me. Your kindness is what pulls me up. Your love is all that draws me in. I will lift my eyes to the maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the oceans raging wild. I will lift my eyes to the healer of the hurt I hold inside. I will lift my eyes, lift my eyes to you. So hold me now. I will lift my eyes to the maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the oceans raging wild. I will lift my God, my God, I cry out, your beloved needs you now.
A
A reading from 2 Corinthians. Paul writes, I must go on boasting. Though there is nothing to be gained by it, I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And he heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. On behalf of this man, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. Though if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from being conceited. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus went away from there and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. And on the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue. And many who heard him were astonished, saying, where did this man get these things? What is the wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, son of Mary and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. And Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor, except in his hometown and among his relatives and in his own household. And he could do no mighty work there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went out among the villages teaching. And he called the 12 and began to send them out 2 by 2 and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He charged them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not put on 2 tunics. And he said to them, whenever you enter a house, stay there until you depart from there. And if any place will not receive you and they will not listen to you, when you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that people should repent. And they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and healed them. The Gospel of the Lord. Seated. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, folks, you know that I really enjoy challenging you to see if you remember
what has been preached in the past. Okay? Like in the middle of a sermon series, I might ask you if you remember what was said in the first part of the series. But today, I would like to take that to a new level. A new level. Instead of this summer, how about the summer of 2016? Okay? Yeah. A lot of good things happened in the summer of 2016. I won't get into it. Those things. But during the summer of 2016, Pastor Joe and I preached a series of sermons on the Lord's Prayer. Remember it? Yeah, shake your heads, like, make me feel good. We preached on the petitions of the Lord's Prayer. That's what we did. And we started with what is called the introduction to the Lord's Prayer, the first six words, Our Father who art in heaven. And I made a statement 2 years ago, a little over 2 years ago now, is at the beginning of the series, about the importance of those six words, okay? And I repeated that, over and over and over again throughout the summer of 2016. Anyone remember what it was? Thank you, Mr. Penjorn. He wasn't here. Yeah, they didn't know that last night. Okay. Thank you, John. Yeah, very good. Thank you. Oh, boy, touch my heart. The other thing that happened in the summer of 2016, Dawson, you know what it was? That was so good? Cubs won the World Series. I had to, Pastor. I couldn't resist. I made it through the whole sermon last night without sharing that simple fact. Okay, but back to what John said, okay? Without our Father who art in heaven, there is no rest of the prayer. That's what we talked about. And that's why it's so important. Our Father who art in heaven. Without our Father who art in heaven, there's no rest of the prayer. Nothing else is part of our prayer life without our Father who art in heaven. Now, in Psalm 123, that's where the psalmist started. Did you hear it? As it was read, listen to it again. To you I lift up my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens. Our Father, who art in heaven, to you I lift up my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens. And it is out of that opening petition that the rest of the psalm proceeds. Because it's all based on our Father who art in heaven. And this Father of ours, this God of ours, has also chosen to be present on earth. And he has chosen to be present on earth in the person of our Lord Christ. Because our Lord Jesus has come. He has come and he is God, Emmanuel, God with us. He is God in the flesh. And he has come to make us the children of our Father. And if you look at this short psalm, Psalm 1, 2, 3, you will see that it reflects the trials of being a child of God. Talks about the contempt of the proud. Folks, this was a song of ascent. And one of the songs of ascent, they were sung as the people of Israel made their way up to Jerusalem. And it's literally up to Jerusalem because you climb an elevation to get to the holy city. And as they went, they were going to the temple for their annual religious feasts. And as they went, They went looking for relief from the scorn and the contempt of the people around them, right down to along the way. There were robbers. There were thieves who would be in the desert, and they would be there to rip them off, to injure them, to harm them. Remember the parable of the Good Samaritan? Jesus based it on fact. In fact, this business of facing the scorn and contempt of others, Jesus faced it. He knew what it was. Today's gospel reading. Did you catch that? He got it from his own hometown folks. Who is this guy? Who is this guy? And they made Jesus dismayed. They made him dismayed. Boy, and I can't think of the exact word. Hold on a second. Hold on a second. Okay. Oh, marveled. He marveled. You know what? Did you catch what makes Jesus marvel? Unbelief. He marveled at their disbelief. He had come as the Messiah. He had come as the Savior. He had come to bring the mercy which Kristen sang about with the children. He had come to bring God to the people, and they didn't believe it. He marveled at that. And he received their scorn, he received their contempt, and he still went about the Father's business, because Jesus was always in contact with our Father, who art in heaven. Those late night and early morning sneakaways to pray, they were for him to reconnect and stay connected to our Father who art in heaven. Martin Luther, the blessed reformer, he practiced that. One of his most famous quotes was when someone asked him, "Dr. Luther, how long do you pray every day?" And Luther looked at him. He said, "I pray 1 hour. I pray for 1 hour every morning, except on the days when I have a lot of important things to do. Then I pray 2 hours." Is that your pattern? Or when you're busy, do you skip through the whole thing and get right at it? Our Father who art in heaven is the one who guides us, who gives us hope, who gives us salvation, who gives us everything. But what's the position we find ourselves in relationship to our Father? That's in the Psalm 2. Verse 2, he goes on to say, after he puts this, he or she, the psalmist, puts this into a place where it can be handled. "You who are enthroned in the heavens, I can bring my problems to our Father who art in heaven, because he's big enough to handle them all." Listen to what he says, or what's said in verse 2. "Behold, as the eyes of servants look to the hand of their master, as the eyes of a maidservant to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look to the Lord our God, till he has mercy upon us." Until the relief comes, what's the posture? To our Father who art in heaven. It is the posture of a servant. Because the servant not only gets relief from the hand of their master or mistress, the servant also watches the master or mistress to be put into action. Okay? Perhaps many of you have waited tables. I did that in St. Louis for a catering company when I was at the seminary. And I remember being taught that you had to anticipate what the person you were serving needed. Was the water glass getting empty? Did the coffee cup need to be fulfilled? Did you need to offer another cocktail? Did that plate need to be cleared? Anticipation of the one you're serving. And that's what Psalm 123 is about. Because it is from the hand of the Master, the one whom we serve, that we take our cues and we get our clues of what to do next and anticipate what God wants us to do. And folks, you don't have to look far. You only have to look to Matthew 22, 34 to 40. No, that's not part of the quiz from earlier. Okay? Because in Matthew 22, 34 to 40, Jesus was asked, "Teacher, what's the greatest commandment in the law?" And the answer was this: the greatest commandment is this, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And the second is just like it, love your neighbor as yourself. So how do you love your neighbor as yourself? Folks, you can find those. It's called the second table of the law, commandments 4 through 10. And the fifth commandment, thou shalt not kill, teaches us to be concerned with the bodily needs of others. And the sixth commandment, you shall not commit adultery, teaches us to be concerned about the family life of others. And when family lives get destroyed for a myriad of reasons, God invites us to be concerned about that and show that concern. The seventh commandment is you shall not steal. And Jesus teaches us to be concerned with the economic realities and the economic needs of others. The eighth commandment, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor, teaches us to be concerned about the reputation of others and to defend it, speak well of them, and put the best construction on everything. Now, when you deal with the needs of others as well as of your own needs in this broken, sinful world, it will not take you further from God. It will draw you back closer to God. Because the only reason we're concerned for those needs of others is found in the explanations to those commandments. We should fear and love God so that we should fear and love our Father who art in heaven, so that we take his concern, his care, his love, his hope into a sin-sick and dying world. Folks, it's all from him. And it starts with his gift of grace and our longing eyes being focused on him, not only for our salvation, but for our action. You might find some young people and adults who have purple shirts on, as Amy Neiman, our youth director, has on this morning. Those shirts were worn on their mission and service trip to Green Bay. What else would Minnesota group wear? To Green Bay than purple. Everything's planned and purposeful at Beautiful Savior, correct? What else would they wear to Green Bay? You think they're going to wear green and gold? But you see, right, Amy? Those four commandments we just talked about. Concern for the bodily needs of others. Concern for the family needs of others. Concern for the economic needs of others, concern for the reputations of others. Because of our Father who art in heaven is why they went. And to learn about that. Because those young people have a lifetime of service to our Father who art in heaven ahead of them. But without our Father who art in heaven, there are no mission trips, there are no service projects. But with our Father who art in heaven, who has become one of us in Christ, there's everything. And he will bring relief. We are like those pilgrims going up the elevation. There are lots of people whose contempt will be shown toward us. Oh, child of God, if you haven't experienced it yet, get ready. But remember, folks, you show contempt for God all the time. That's not just someone else's issue. But as we march to the upward elevation of eternity, our Father who art in heaven, who is enthroned there, bids us to come. And in Christ, he makes it possible. He makes it possible. It's his gift. So I ask you this morning, why would you look anywhere else? Why would you look anywhere else but to our Father who is enthroned in the heavens, yet who chooses to be present in Christ on the earth? Our eyes don't have to long for anyone else, because our Father, who art in heaven, is also in us. Amen?
Amen,
amen, Pastor.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please remain standing for prayer. Growing in faith and discipleship, we give thanks for God's merciful compassion as we pray for the church, the world, and all in need.
Lord God, equip all your faithful people for the work of mission. When we are empty-handed, give us partners in ministry. Help us to speak boldly of your promises without reservation or fear, here and at Bethlehem Lutheran Church in Crete, Nebraska, and Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Vredenburg, Alabama. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, you breathe life into the dust of the earth. Bless the land and all who work it. Bring relief to areas of drought and famine. Send healing rains and cooling breezes to places scorched by sun and heat. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, when the nations are rebellious, raise up prophets and leaders to proclaim your way of justice. Provide for the needs of refugees, immigrants, asylum seekers, and exiles. Protect all who live in areas of war and conflict. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, your glory shines throughout the world. We commend our nation to your merciful care, that we may live securely in peace and may be guided by your providence. Give all in authority the wisdom and strength to know your will and to do it. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, your grace is sufficient to bring wholeness to human weakness. Restore hope to those suffering hardships, persecutions, and calamities. Strengthen all who are fragile in body, mind, or spirit, especially those we name before you now, silently or aloud. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, all that we possess is from your loving hand. Give us grace that we may honor you with all our talents and treasures, always remembering the giver as we continue to grow in generosity. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, renew our commitment to the work of hospitality. Help us to offer a caring welcome to visitors and to those returning to the church. Help us to be living examples of your grace and your generosity. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, you give us times of refreshment and peace in the course of this busy life. Grant safety for those who travel, and grant us all renewal of our minds and bodies in the use of our leisure. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, you equip disciples throughout the ages to proclaim your kingdom. Lead us by faith until every weakness of this world has been made perfect in the power of your everlasting glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we lift to you these prayers and the prayers of our hearts, trusting in your everlasting love and mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated, and our worship continues with the offering.
Please stand for prayer. Let us pray. Merciful God, you open wide your hand and satisfy the need of every living thing. You have set this feast before us. Open our hands to receive it. Open our hearts to embrace it. Open our lives to live it. We pray this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Pastor Joe. Jonathan.
Dear friends, Jesus comes to us here in this meal, his body and blood in with and under the bread and wine given and shed so that we receive his mercy, his love, his forgiveness in our lives. And so we invite you to come and receive those gifts that are yours through Christ. The table is set. Please be seated. Would you please stand? And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in his joy and in his peace. Amen.
Let us pray. Wise and generous God, we thank you that at this holy table, you have fed us again with the food of everlasting life. Send us with your blessing to seek the good of our neighbor and to call others to your feast. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. We have just two quick announcements here for you this morning. First of all, members of our prayer team are available after worship here today to pray with you. If you have something going on in your life that you'd like to pray about, joys, struggles, whatever it may be, you could find them through those doors over there, or if you head out through these doors, just hang a left all the way to that side of the building. Like I said, they'll be there to help you, to pray with you, to go to our God who is in heaven, who is there for us, as Pastor Tom talked about so beautifully today in the sermon. So please feel free to go over there after worship and lift up those prayers to our God. The second thing is, you may have seen some of the signs on Schmidt Lake Road talking about a potential road closure on Schmidt Lake Road. Just kind of like Paul in the second lesson talking about the third heaven, right? We have no idea what that's about, okay? They got it. Last night, the service did not get it at all, so thank you. Bad pastor jokes are appreciated. Thank you for that. So we don't know exactly what's going on. There is the potential that this entrance might be closed depending on how this whole construction thing goes. So please keep that in mind as you come next week, because we will be open. So please feel free to use that entrance over there on that side of the campus. If this side is closed, just plan ahead and be ready for some of those changes as they arise. Okay? All right. We'll receive the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Go in peace. The Spirit sends us forth to serve.
Thanks be to God.